Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our service this morning. We pray that the Lord will bless you as you join in with us. I'd like to share a call to worship. It says, "Light of God, surround us. Love of God, enfold us. Power of God, protect us. Presence of God, watch over us. Mind of God, guide us. Law of God, direct us. Wherever we are, God be our strength and harbor."
Amen. Beautiful words for us this morning, or this afternoon, or this evening, whenever you're watching this. Well, we're going to sing a few choruses together, and it says, "Able to save, able to keep, yes, my Lord is able." Now, we've been joking, because next week it will be the task, and I said to the gentleman, it'll be just the three amigos right now, but we're going to convince, hopefully, someone else to join us, because Velma's leaving, not leaving me, but she's going on 2 weeks vacation to go visit her mom. So it'll be just Lucas on the guitar, and David, and me singing along with them. And so pray for us that the Lord will use us in a mighty way. But it's able to save, able to keep. Yes, my Lord is able. Giving me grace, giving me power. Yes, my Lord is able. He has turned the darkest night to day. That's the reason I can say he's able to save, able to keep. It's Christ, my Savior. Let's sing it together, the words that are from you.
Able to save, able to keep.
Another chorus says, "It is no longer I that liveth, but Christ that liveth in me." In me, in me. Jesus is alive in me. It is no longer I that liveth, but Christ that liveth in me. And that's what happens when we ask Jesus within our hearts. So sing it together. It is no longer I that liveth.
It is no longer I.
Yeah.
to say that. Lucas, you're coming through good and clear. We had a little joke with Lucas. You got to sing into the mic to get used to it, because he's really got to sing next week. Chorus says, redeemed and now I'm free. All glory to his name. Jesus reached down to the gutters of sin and shame. To want to save a wretched soul from a life of misery. New life is mine since Jesus set me free. Do you want to be set free today? Is there someone out there that the Lord is tugging on your heart? Do you feel that you're a wretched soul and that you want to be saved? Well, this is a day for you. This is a day for you. Redeemed, and now I'm free. Four of us can say that here today. Amen. That we've been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb of Jesus Christ. Let's sing it together. Redeemed, and now I'm free.
Redeemed, and now I'm free.
Come every soul by sin oppressed. There's mercy. Hallelujah with the Lord. And he will surely give you rest. By what? By trusting in his word. Let's sing verses 1 and 2 together. And the chorus, of course, a couple of times as well. Come every soul.
Come every soul by sin oppressed.
Yeah.
Yes, Jesus is the truth, the way that leads you into rest. Believe in Him without delay, and then you are fully blessed. Do you want to be blessed today? Then accept Jesus within your heart. Only trust Him. Only trust Him now. He will save you. He will save you. He will save you at this very moment. Let's sing that last verse together. Yes, Jesus is the truth and the way.
Yes, Jesus is the truth.
Major, he's a scripture, and he also has a prayer with us this morning. God bless you, Sergeant Major.
Good morning. The scripture reading this morning is taken from John's Gospel, chapter 6, verse 35 to 40. Then Jesus declared, "I am the bread of life. He who comes to me will never go hungry, and he who believes in me will never be thirsty. But as I told you, you have seen me, and still you don't believe. All that my Father gives me will come to me, and whoever comes to me, I will never drive away. For I have come down from heaven, not to do my will, but to do the will of Him who sent me. And this is the will of Him who sent me, that I shall lose none of all that He has given me, but raise them up in the last days. For my Father's will is that everyone who looks to the Son and believes in Him shall have eternal life. And I will raise him up at the last days." May God add a blessing to the reading of His Word today. Well, this morning, just for a few moments, we're going to just have a prayer this morning with the people in our congregation. And I've turned to a song, a beautiful song in our song book. And I know this morning, because it's been a pretty rough week probably for some people, and it's been a hard week with the accidents that's happened around our communities and everything. And in our songbook, it's Psalm 427. Is there a heart or bound by sorrow? Is there a life weighed down by care? Come to the cross, each burden bearing. All your anxieties, leave them there. God promised us that, didn't He? No other friend so keen to help you. No other friend so quick to hear. No other place to leave your burdens, no other place, no other one, sorry, to hear your prayer. And then it says, come at once. So whatever's on your heart this morning, the problems of life, I pray that you would come at once to this wonderful Savior who loves you so much. Shall we pray? God, our Heavenly Father, we thank you for those beautiful words this morning. And you promised us from Scripture that all our anxieties, all our cares, whatever that problem looks like for people this morning, that we can come to you and we can lay them at your feet. Father, I thank you for the people in this choir who follow us each Sunday on social media or whatever way they follow. I pray, Father, that you will bless them, and as we proclaim the gospel once again today, Father, that they will have ears to hear and open their eyes, Lord, that they may see that you came down from heaven to do the will of your Father. And you promised us that whoever believed in you, that you would never leave them, you would never forsake them. So, Father, there may be some older folk in our core this evening who are struggling with the different situations that they find themselves in. But may they always realize that they have a friend in Jesus, and no other friend to care for them like He does. In those lonely nights where they think they have no friend nearby, no family members around them, Father, I pray that they would realize that your arms are wrapped around them and that you love them so much and you care for them. And Lord, for those in our family this morning who will be watching and don't know you as their Savior, Lord, I pray this morning that something that may be said by Violet as she brings forth your word in a little while, or something that may be said, Lord, from other things in this service today. I pray, Father, that they would heed the warnings that would be given. Lord, just bless our people in Jesus' name as I give you thanks. Amen.
Well, thank you, Sergeant Major, for that prayer. And we're going to sing a prayer song, and it says, all your anxiety, all your care, bring to the mercy seat, leave it there. Well, the mercy seat in the Salvation Army is just what we call a piece of wood. No significance to it at all. Just the significance that when we kneel, we're kneeling at the feet of Jesus. The mercy seat for you this morning could be in your dining room, could be in your living room, could be up in your cabin, wherever you're watching this, that you can kneel at the feet of Jesus. It says, leave it there. Never a burden he cannot bear. There's nothing that we cannot bring to the Lord. Never a friend like Jesus. Let's sing it to a couple of times. All your anxiety, all your care.
All your anxiety.
Draw me back or turn my heart from thee, but by the Calvary track bring me at last to see the courts of God, that city fair, and find my name is written there.
Thank you. the Lord on Damascus Road, never was the same again. Peter met the Lord, he left his boat and started fishing for men. Well, I may not be Peter or Paul, but one thing I can surely say is when I met the Lord and I made him my choice, he definitely made a change. Made a change in the way that I'm walking, made a change in the way I'm talking. Old things pass away, behold, everything's new. He made a change in the life that I'm living. I'm born again, set free, totally forgiven. If he can make a change in me, he can make a change in you. Well, I see old friends shaking their heads, for they never thought they'd see the day when a sinner like me would praise the Lord or bow his head to pray. But I'm not what I used to be, for my life's been rearranged. It's nothing I've done, but I found someone who could definitely make a change. Made a change in the way that I'm walking, made a change in the way I'm talking. Old things pass away, behold, everything's new. He made a change in the life that I'm living. I'm born again, set free, totally forgiven. If he can make a change in me, he can make a change in you. He made a change in the way that I'm walking, made a change in the way I'm talking. Old things pass away, behold, everything's new. He made a change in the life that I'm living. I'm born again, set free, totally forgiven. If he can make a change in me, he can make a change in you. If he can make a change in me, he can make a change in you.
We're going to sing another song together. I hope that you're singing along with us. I guess myself and Velma are aging ourselves now, and Lucas or David, I can't remember, asked, is this a contemporary song? Well, it's contemporary to us, but it's a beautiful song. Jesus, what a beautiful name. Son of God, Son of Man, Lamb that was slain. Joy and peace, strength and all, grace that blows all fear away. Jesus. What a beautiful name. Jesus, what a beautiful name. Truth revealed, my future sealed, healed by my pain. Love and freedom, life and warmth, grace that blows all fear away. Jesus, what a beautiful, beautiful name. And we're going to be blessed this morning as Violet brings the word of God. And that, I think the title of her message is that God is in the midst. And God is in the midst through it all. And what a beautiful Savior that we have. We're going to sing this fourth verse, straight down through. Sing along with us. And it's a beautiful tune together. Jesus, what a beautiful name.
Jesus, what a beautiful name.
Yeah.
Once again, we're blessed. We've heard so many compliments about our children's time, and this morning we're going to be blessed by Anna Chalk. And I don't know if her children are going to be there. I know with David and their family, their children make children's time, and it makes it so real. So I don't know if it's Anna, if it's just you, but whatever it is, we're going to be blessed as she brings children's time to us this morning.
Hello, boys and girls. How's everyone doing today? I hope you guys have had a wonderful week. This morning, I would like to share a Bible story with you guys, taken from Matthew 25 and 4. The king will reply, "I tell you the truth, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers of mine, you did for me." So, when someone does something nice for us, what do we usually do? We usually say, "Thank you." But sometimes that don't seem to be enough. Sometimes we'll send a thank you card, a little thank you gift to show our appreciation. Everyone loves receiving a little thank you gift or a thank you card. Another way we can show thanks is if someone, say, invited you over for supper and you really enjoyed your time and really enjoyed your meal, then sometimes we might invite them to our place at another time to show how much we appreciated going to theirs. It's always important to show everyone, kids, adults, everyone appreciation for stuff they does, isn't it? Everyone loves to know that they're appreciated and loves to hear thanks. But I don't know anyone who has done more for us than what God has done. God provides us food when we're hungry, water when we're thirsty. He provides healing when we're sick and comfort when we are super sad. He's there for us all the time. The Bible tells us that he is an ever-present healer in times of trouble. So no matter what, we can always go to God because he is there for us. Now, because of all that God has done for us, we can say thank you, but somehow that doesn't seem like it's enough sometimes. And we could write a thank you letter, but I don't really think the post office will deliver there. So I think I have a pretty good idea. Why don't we do something nice in return for him? But how? How can we do something nice in return for God who does everything for us? Well, Jesus told us how to do it. Jesus said, "Whatever you do for one of the least of these brothers of mine, you do for me." That means when someone is hungry and you feed them, it is the same as doing it for Jesus. When we visit the sick or make a card for the sick, it's the same as doing it for Jesus. When we give clothes to people in need, it's the same thing as giving clothes to Jesus. Whatever we do for others, is Jesus feels it too. And that is a very special way of showing our appreciation to Jesus. Now, there's a very special name for this way of saying thank you. I think we should call it thanksgiving. Thanksgiving is when we show our thanks by the way we live. Thanksgiving is when we look at the many ways God has blessed us and we thank him by blessing others. Because that's how he would want us to live, right? He wants us to bless others like he is blessing our lives. And we should try to do that every day with our living. We should always try to treat others and bless others the same way Jesus would bless and treat us. That's right, kids. So let's pray and ask our God to help us to offer thanksgiving by thanksgiving. Hands up together. Our Father, we come into your presence with thanksgiving. Help us to turn our thanksgiving into thanksgiving and to live each day as you would like us to live, and bless others like you bless us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Have a great Sunday, everyone.
Well,
My name is Violet. If you don't know me, Violet Whalen from the Clarenville Corps. I'm going to present God's Word to you this morning. But before I do, I want to have a prayer. Dear God, our Heavenly Father, we pause in your presence today and we give you thanks for all your blessings that you bestow upon us. You give us grace sufficient to meet our needs. And Father, just now as I stand, I pray, O God, that the sweet dew of heaven would fall upon me through your power and through your Holy Spirit. And the words that you have prepared me to say, Lord, I pray that people that will listen today will apply it to their hearts and will want to know you in a personal way. So, dear God, I pray now that you will take control and that you will have your way in my life and in the lives of those who will listen to this message. In Jesus' name, for your honor and glory, I pray. Amen. Where is God? First, I'd like to tell a little story. A couple had two little boys, age 8 and 10, who were beyond mischievous. They were always getting into trouble, and their parents knew that. If any mischief occurred in their town, their sons were probably involved. The boy's mother heard that a pastor in town had been successful in disciplining children. So she asked if he would speak to her boys. The pastor agreed, but asked to see them individually. So the mother sent her 8-year-old first in the morning, with the older boy to see the pastor in the afternoon. The pastor, a huge man with a booming voice, sat the younger boy down and asked him sternly, "Where is God?" The boy's mouth dropped open, but he made no response, sitting there with his mouth hanging open and wide-eyed. So the pastor repeated the question and in an even sterner voice, "Where is God?" Again, the boy made no attempt to answer. So the pastor raised his voice even more and shook his finger in the boy's face and bellowed, "Where is God?" And the boy screamed and bolted from the room, ran directly home and dove into his closet and slammed the door behind him. When his older brother found him in the closet, he asked, "What happened?" And the younger brother, gasping for breath, replied, "We are in big trouble now, dude. God is missing, and they think we did it." Well, for a few minutes this morning, I'd like you to listen to my message. And I'll start with the words, "We are in a time where people are wondering where God is. Did we lose God somewhere along the line? Our society seems to be in chaos. I will not make a false statement that it is the worst society ever. But nevertheless, our society seems to be bursting out at the seams. We are seeing more and more school violence. We are seeing more drug and alcohol abuse. Society is becoming increasingly violent. And the family structure is under attack by those who are trying to define what God calls a marriage. Those who do stand for righteousness are called intolerant. We have churches on every corner, but that doesn't seem to make a difference. We have churches that are in chaos. They are dying, and some not having reached lost people for the gospel for years. It is not God's will that the world and the church and our personal lives are in a state of confusion and chaos. Wherever God is not present, my friends, there is chaos and confusion. Just imagine what would happen to the universe if God were to remove his hand from it. Just imagine what would happen to the universe if God were to remove his hand from it. Think about how society would be without God being a part of it. Think about what would happen to the church when God is not in the center of it? How would your life be without God being a part of it? Just for a few moments today, I want us to look at another attribute of our awesome God. Our God is a God of order, not confusion. In Genesis 1, 1 and 2, we read how God brought order to the universe. In the passage in Genesis, we find that in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And verse 2 tells us that the earth was formless and void. The terms formless and void were meant to convey the idea of confusion and disorder. God created the earth to be inhabited. But for a brief time before he created plants, animals, and man, light, and so forth, the earth was void of anything. If God had just left things the way they were in Genesis 1 and 2, there would be no life. The psalmist in Psalm 8, 3 and 4 says, "When I consider your heavens, the works of your fingers, the moon and the stars, which you have ordained, what is man that you take thought of him? And the son of man that you care for him?" God set the universe in order. Many people think that the universe happened by accident. Think about a couple of things with me. The universe is set up in an orderly manner. There are billions of stars and planets in the universe, yet they are all in orderly orbits. What are the odds? The movement of the planets of our solar system is so precise. Scientists can calculate exactly where the planet will be 100 years in advance. We know by research done by others when the comets are going to pass by us again. We know that the Earth rotates on its axis at a tilt of 23 degrees, which allows for a greater surface of the Earth to be tilted and makes possible the seasons. I could go on and on about God's wonderful creation. In Romans 1:20 it says, "For since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes, his eternal power and divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood through what has been made, so that they are without excuse." Paul says that God has made himself visible to all through the design and order of creation. Psalm 19 and 1, "The heavens are telling the glory of God, and their expanse is declaring the work of his hands." God wants to bring order to society. Jeremiah 4 and 23. In the book of Jeremiah, God had instructed the prophet to preach to the people about what would happen to them unless they repented and turned to the Lord and put their trust in him and in their society. Jeremiah warned them in verse 23, "The earth, and behold, it was formless and void. And the heavens, they had no light." This is the same phrase that was used in Genesis 1 and 2. The prophet was telling them that the land and their nation would be destroyed and would end up in utter chaos unless they repented and returned to God. The nation was pushing God out of the picture, and Jeremiah was trying to warn them of the consequences of doing that. In the chapter 5 of the book of Jeremiah, it lists six reasons why God was going to judge them. Listen to these with me and see if any of them sound familiar. Moral corruption, rejecting God. Sexual impurity, committing adultery. Unbelief. They did not believe that God would do what he said he would. Religious apostasy. God said they would be destroyed because of their worship of false gods. Social injustice. The rich were cheating the poor. Their houses were full of ill-gotten gain. Corrupt leaders. The leaders of the nations, kings, prophets, priests, were leading people down the wrong path. Friends, today that was written in Jeremiah way back in the Old Testament. But today it seems like today's newspaper we're reading. In our world today is an effort to remove God from our society. Just listen to just a couple of these social indicators. Marriage is becoming less and less popular. Families are in turmoil. Violent crimes are on the rise. Terrorist attacks. Drugs and alcohol are destroying people's lives. Suicide. This is what happens when we take God out. We end up with a society in chaos. Today we don't want Bibles or prayer or the Ten Commandments in our schools. Just a while ago the decision was made to take the cross down from a school in St. John's because of one person's voice. What they are saying is that you can't let the kids see the Ten Commandments because if they do, they might obey the things like don't steal, don't kill, and that would be unconstitutional. The founders of this country was built upon the foundation of Jesus. Our whole system of laws and government are based on the principles of God's word. Whenever we try to toss God out of our society, our laws don't even make sense. Our country is paying a price for trying to rid itself of God. I want to remind you today that God does not want our society to break into chaos. God wants to bring order to it. God wants to bring order to the church. When God is in the center of the church, there is peace within the church. When our personal agendas take over God's agenda, the church will be in turmoil. When we put God in the center of the church, God will bring order and peace to the church, and he will reap his blessings upon it. God wants to bring order to your life and to mine. Romans 5:1 tells us, therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Peace is the absence of chaos and disorder. When we give our lives over to Jesus, we are then at peace with God. As we turn over areas of our lives to God, we will experience order, peace, and blessings from God. Think of how many people are living in chaos because they have ignored God and his calling. Think about how many people are living in chaos because we have not taken the gospel message to them in love. God sent his son to die for us. He does not want us to live in chaos. Jesus will bring peace in our lives. Our lives will have an ultimate purpose and direction. Paul joyfully writes in Romans 16:19-20, for the report of your obedience have reached to all. Therefore, I am rejoicing over you. But I want you to be wise in what is good and innocent and what is evil. The God of peace will soon crush Satan under your feet, and the grace of our Lord Jesus be with you. And Paul there is telling the people that because of their love and obedience to the Lord, that God was not going to let Satan wreak havoc in their lives. God wants to bring order and peace into your life and to mine. You know, one of the most amazing truths I have ever encountered in the Bible is the truth that God invites people to come to him. He is the Savior of sinners, Have you trusted him as your Savior? The song we sing sometimes in our church says, have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? In John 10, 9 and 10, Jesus said, I am the door. If anyone enters through me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal, kill, and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it more abundantly. Just think what would happen if God were to remove his hand from the universe. Look at what is happening in a society that is trying to distance itself from God. As things get worse, we wait to go to God. After a shooting happens, we wait to go to God. Our kids get into trouble, we wait to go to God. Sickness and death, we wait to go to God. Financial problems, we wait to go to God. God loves you, and you need to know that. God wants to come into your life. He wants to give you eternal life. You will only find that through Jesus Christ. Have you trusted Jesus Christ as your Savior? Have you responded to his invitation for you to come and see? He is still calling those who do not know him to come for salvation. If you will come, you can and will be saved. It is one thing to hear about Jesus Christ and what he can do. It is another thing altogether to experience him for yourself and to know what he can do in your life. I praise God for every testimony of salvation recorded in the Word of God. But I am even more thankful for that day when Jesus invited me to come and see. I am glad Jesus saved me. I am glad he saved Paul and John and Peter and the rest. I rejoice with them. But when he saved me, he gave me a testimony. And I'll just brief a little part of my testimony to you this morning, whenever you're listening. I remember a week before I got saved, and that was 37 years ago. The church was opened every day for prayer. My mom and my dad would go sometime during the day for the whole week to pray for their 10 children. The following Sunday night, my two sisters and I decided to go to church because it was our church anniversary Sunday after all. After the pastor delivered the message and gave the invitation for anyone who would like to accept Jesus as their Savior, without hesitating, I got up from my seat and I made my way to the altar. Before I knelt down, a voice in my ear said, Violet, you know you won't be able to live the same lifestyle you lived before, the one that you live with your sisters. Now, we didn't commit any great sin, but we lived our lives outside of the will of God. Well, I ignored that voice, because I was ready to give my heart to Jesus Christ. Well, just a little while, someone tapped on my shoulders. And when I looked up, I saw my two sisters coming. And they knelt and they gave their hearts to Jesus. Friends, Jesus not only saved me that night, he saved my two sisters as well. That voice I heard in my ear was from Satan. And I'm happy to tell you, he got defeated, and God got the victory. And my mom's and dad's prayers were answered. Since then, my mom and my dad and my sister Bernice are gone home to be with Jesus. My sister Donna and I are serving the Lord, and let me tell you, it's the best decision I ever made. Have we had difficulties? Sicknesses, sorrow, disappointments? Oh, yes. But God has always been there with us, holding our hand. And he has never failed us. He is a faithful God, and I love him more and more every day. Now, when you share yours, it bears witness with mine, and I can rejoice in what Jesus did for you. He did it to me, hallelujah, and he can do it for you. This thing we have, as my dad used to say in his testimony, is better felt than told. When you meet Jesus, your life will change forever. We are living in a world where people are seeking answers. They are looking for direction, fulfillment, and hope. If you are among that number and you are looking for more from your life, you need to know that his invitation to come and see still stands. You have tried everything else and nothing has scratched the itch in your soul. Come to Jesus. You've tried church and it didn't work. Come to Jesus. You've tried sin, alcohol, drugs, sex, and every worldly thing you can imagine, but nothing has worked. Come to Jesus. You need help, and you can't seem to find it anywhere. Come to Jesus. Maybe you've tried Jesus in the past, and he didn't work. The problem was not with him, it was with you. This time, don't just try him. Surrender to him totally and let him save you and take control of your life. Come to Jesus. If there's any needs today, who's listening to my voice, whether you are saved or lost in sin, you need help of some kind, come to Jesus. I'm going to finish now with the words of a beautiful psalm, and I pray that you will make it your prayer. It says, to the river I am going, bringing sins I cannot bear. Come and cleanse me. Come, forgive me. Lord, I need to meet you there. In these waters, healing mercy flows with freedom from despair. I am going to that river. Lord, I need to meet you there. Precious Jesus, I am ready. Are you ready? To surrender every care. Take my hand now. Lead me closer. Lord, I need to meet you there. Come and join us in the river. Come find life beyond compare. He is calling. He is waiting. Jesus longs to meet you there.
Thank you, Lada, for sharing with us from the Word this morning the challenge that's been presented for us to give our lives to Jesus Christ, because he wants to give us peace. He wants to give us calm in the midst of chaos. And the moment that we turn to Jesus Christ and invite him into our lives, then he changes us and makes us a new creation. We're going to sing the song that Violet mentioned. To the river I'm going, bringing sins I cannot bear. Come and cleanse me. Come forgive me. Lord, I need to meet you there.
To the river I am going, bringing sins I cannot bear. Come and cleanse me. Come forgive me. Lord, I need to meet you there. In this water,
cherish. There is a river that flows from deep within.
Amen.
There is a fountain that frees the soul from sin. Come to the waters, there is a vast supply. There is a river that never shall run dry. And when the Samaritan woman came to the well, she came to get water that would quench her physical thirst. But she left having her spiritual thirst quenched.
Amen.
And she found and met Jesus, and her life was changed. And the same is true for any today who call on his name.
Thank you, Lord.
Saving power of Jesus Christ that can and will happen. Fill my cup.
This thirsting of my soul. Bread of heaven, feed me till I want no more. Fill my cup. Fill it up and make me whole. And I assure you, if you sang that this morning with your heart, then he's going to fill up your cup. Well, our closing number this morning is My Hope is Built on Nothing Less Than Jesus' Blood and Righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but only lean on Jesus' name. On Christ, the solid rock, I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. Sing along with us. I want to thank the gentlemen once again for being here with us. And gentlemen, please show up here next week because my wife is gone for a couple of weeks. And if you got any extra food at home or anything, you know, I'll be hungry. And so I got a joke because the Clarenville people are putting weight on me that I'm supposed to have lost, but that I'm blaming it all on you, but you folk. But let's sing along together, and we pray that God indeed will speak to you this morning. On Christ the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus.
Sing that second verse again. And as I was thinking of that, I thought of my grandfather Jackson. And I remember fishing with him when I used to come up from Corner Brook, and Mom and Dad would put me on the train, and they would pick me up in Whitburn, Uncle Wolf, and all of them. And I would love to go fishing with Pop. And I remember when we were putting out the trap, and we had to go ashore, and we had to put down a big steel rod down in the shore, and then we put the leader, they called it. And I remember, and I said, Pop, what's all that about? And he said, well, that's what keeps the net in place. That's what the leader is all about. That's what keeps us solid. But he reminded me as well. He said, you may sing a song sometime. He said, young Billy, he called me. And it's a song that says, in all and every stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. Now, he reminded me of that. Some of you in my family will not realize that, but Pop knew about that. And I praise God for that. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor, who is Jesus Christ, holds within the veil. Let's sing that verse in the chorus a couple of times.
When darkness sinks to highest face, I rest on it.
Thank you, Lord, for the privilege that you have given us to present your word. We thank you, Lord, for our servant, for your servant, Violet, Lord, who, Father, brought your word, Father, reminding us that you're in the midst of it all. Thank you, Lord, for such songs, dear Lord, that my anchor, you, Father, hold us in the hollow of your hand. And every stormy gale, whatever may come in our life, you are there in the midst of it all. So, Lord, we thank you for that. Father, I pray just now, Lord, your blessing upon our people. I think of Clarenville folk, dear Lord, and Random Island, Father, and the town of Clarenville and the vicinity, Lord. May, Father, you continue to watch over us and guide us by your Spirit. So, Lord, we give you all the praise and all the glory. And, Lord, I pray just now, selfishly, dear Lord, that as my wife, Father, leaves for 2 weeks vacation to visit her mom, and, Father, our daughter goes with her with young Ophelia, I pray, dear Lord, that you will watch over them. And Father, that you would protect them and bring them back safely. So Lord, once again, thank you for the privilege of being able to worship you this morning. Watch over us. Continue, Father, to guide us by your Spirit until we're able, Father, to come into this place once again. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. God bless you, everyone. Have a great week.